それなんですよ。おたけ君なんだ。
この技術に変えてます。
2つ目は技術、
また言って やん。
はい、
やっとのヘッドは見えます。
Good. But you take me.
There you go.
Yeah. Found. There you go. Yep. Anything that relates pain. Yep. Those are all the energy. Right? And then you also have prescription stuff. You can actually have prescription ibuprofen, over the counter ibuprofen. You can have morphine. Those are all the energy.
Mm-hmm. What's an antagonist? Oh,
right, works up. So what would be the thing that would actually cause this? What's the opposite of impact? Right. So you have an agonist and an impact.
Right. Okay.
Anesthetics?
Mm-hmm.
Not really. Yeah. Basically it, you displace your... But a lot of it is basically truly relieves the pain and or displaces you from the pain. And we'll talk about that. In fact, so it's anxiety. Anybody else? Where is it? And we all have moments where we have anxiety, right? Test anxiety, public speaking anxiety, fear of, So we have anti-anxiety medication. So for the folks where it's an extreme case, you can get medication for that. A sedative hypnotic.
That's a sedative.
Yeah, so versus that, something that kind of takes your nervous, you know, basically your mental status and makes you kind of...
anti-seizure, anti-convulsion,
CNS stimulator. Caffeine,
Actual therapeutic medication.
That becomes kind of more of an anti-convulsion. So basically, things like schizophrenia, bipolar medication, and ANS, PNS, and anxiety. Well, excellent. So you guys are doing good. All right. So neurophysiology.
Simple.
Neurophysiology in one slide. So tell me about it. Explain this slide. So, excellent. So while we're there, let's do it. Excellent. Tell me this. What are we doing? Excellent. Okay.
Let's take a look at it.
Yeah. So the central is the brain spinal cord. The peripheral is good. Yeah. So in EPM, what else? So yeah, I went through that. You control, yeah. So voluntary is something you control. Autonomic basically means relaxing. So like what?
Hormones, something, yeah.
Right. This will also break down the central parasympathetic to be like that. So what are those? You're doing great. All right, so energy, right? So basically, this is a decrease in central tension.
Yes.
So basically, there's lots of ways to break this down, but we're going to kind of look at it here. So you have opioids and non-opioids. What are opioids? Opium comes from, so you have poppy plants, poppy seeds, you get opium out of it, right? So basically you have so within the opioid stuff, we have things that are called agonists and antagonists. It's kind of confusing, isn't it? Well, it's good. Not all opioids are trying to sleep, but you can't stop sleep. It's not so bad. So pretty simple, right? So we'll just break some stuff down. Cool. All of their own thoughts, right? So when you guys are filling out your classes and other forms, whether it's on the drug form, whether it's on that sheet that we talked about earlier, the more specific you can get, the better off life will be. So certainly, it will be the drug class. So if somebody says, hey, here's how you put it, you can go in on this. You're technically the correct answer. The more specific that you put it, so if you said it's an insect, the more specific that you can get it, the better off you're going to be. Because you can always back up. The problem is that this is the level you're operating on, it's hard to dive down. Make sense? So, yes, it's a little more work on your part. But the time that you invest now, it can be rewarded later. Guys see it when you're working with it, and you guys don't need to partner, you can see where they go back and study and where they take nothing. So when you guys are off with the gap, okay? All right, who's this one? Everybody's heard of morphine, right? Morphine is the prototype drug for opioids. It was kind of the first, the primary one. And remember we kind of talked about earlier, did you have something about prototype drugs in there? The prototype is the one that kind of defines the class. Generally, the first one that kind of defines. So every class is a prototype drug. Learn that prototype drug, you have 90% of the influence. A new drug comes out today. It's an opiate. By my knowledge of morphine, I've studied it well. All I need to know is what makes morphine this new drug a little different from the opiate. It happens all the time. There's little pushes, right? In fact, most of them, you can learn it as you kind of go around. But yeah, so that's kind of, so yeah, more than, yeah. And a lot of them, you can kind of go, but it's intentional. Small, beta blockers can be small. So the little things that kind of feed you in, you say, oh, yeah, let's do that. Okay, fine. So it's kind of funny watching this, because the pharmaceutical companies come up with new drugs, and of course, in the pharmaceutical company, it's a new drug, of course, it's a way to do the thing, because it's not going to be television. And it's kind of funny to watch a lot of students. Because they'll go, oh, hey, you've heard this. Folks that kind of take it, they go, yeah, it's great, because here's this, and they'll talk, wow, this drug just came out. You already know about it. You know this. No. Because we know the class of drug, and general kind of that crack upper, and that this drug is under this crack, and that they can tell you no sense. The thing I don't know is what is specifically the little differences of the tweaks, because every drug has slight tweaks, which is why the companies took it out, because it has less side effects or different side effects. They want to market it to the public, and they said it worked better than that. So many years ago, they both do the general thing. But of course, the marketing folks want to make it so we can get the tweaks we get. So, yeah, so that makes sense why you started the prototype one. Alright, so yeah, so this is what we have to do. Alright, so, right, all drugs act on receptors. Opioids have six receptors. We're going to talk about two of them. Here's a list of drugs. Here's the indications, contraindications, side effects, doses. The drug system flipped it out one I didn't get this because I didn't get this. If you learn the parts of the receptor sites and what the receptor sites do, you then understand that you go, okay, this is why it makes sense about this drug. You understand the pharmacology of how the drug works. Slight different kind of tweaks, and they're all non-equipped. Codeine tends to have a much greater effect on prostate than morphine. So guess what codeine is going to do to it? Not so much morphine. So these are all similar, but again, learning kind of what tweaks one more so than the other, where they work, more codeine tends to kind of work more and more time. Basically have a slight, one of the wings is slightly different than the other, which means it crosses the blood-brain barrier. Morphine doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier, but it does, but it's not as fast as heroin. Heroin has no problem. So, see, it's like I got a blood pass on blood pressure, I'm not making my brain. So therefore, as an abuse drug, to get that euphoric effect, to the blood. So if you get the drug addict, you go heroin or morphine, then you go for heroin because of that slight physiology change, that slight chemical structure. Make sense? So all these are very, very similar, but there's little slight structural changes that cause slight differences. Good? Alright, now. So those are both pure agonists. So now we come down here to this thing we talked about, the agonist antagonist. Which one will basically stimulates the capsaicin, which causes antagonistic effects to the nephrites. So remember what you say the nephrites do. What were the bad things that we did wrong? The first question. Physical tendency, right? Yep. Euphoria, right? Yeah. Actually, both of them did that question. But yeah, right? So new day, stayed on, the heart stayed on. Stayed on is one that's done a lot with OBGYN. You give morphine to mom, who's delivering the baby. Mom's happier that morphine crosses the placental barrier. It's in the kid. Now, the kid can come out and have respiratory effects. So that's one of the things. So if mom's within a couple hours of delivering, you really kind of want to watch what we do. Stay long doesn't cross the placental barrier. It doesn't cross the blood-brain barrier, the placental barrier very well. So it's much safer than the one that's commonly given to mom, because if mom has it, doesn't have that respiratory effect. Okay. Now, your impact basically what you get in both of them, that's the Hernarcan, Alicone. There's actually a couple others, longer, they last longer. And that's another thing you kind of have to work. So y'all talked about half-life the other day? All these drugs too. So somebody, right. So my favorite overdose story is a lady who had did surgery, outpatient surgery, went home. They set up the home health care meter at home. And then put it on the PCA. Push the button, yeah. Push the button, yeah. You can push as much as you want, but it's only going to give, it only works on the time. So you can only push the button so many times an hour. And then have it. Set it up at the PCA, pump the morphine. Put it in a syringe pump. So they had a syringe in there, but they put a milligram of morphine. Left it in there, pump it up in there. Set it up, pick it up, start the IV. Get something, hook it up, came back over here, and she just walked this room to speak. Oh, it's 100 milligrams a month. So guess what happens? Sedation, respiratory depression, right? She panics, calls, eventually we get called. But anyway, so we get there. Wonderful. Busy. Next getting bagger. So we said, okay, so 100 milligrams a month, yep. So we went through the process, we intubated, went to do it, and my supervisor shows up and kind of goes off. should be just trying this document. He hopes that he's not going to do a ton of money on marketing, 2 buildings a month. He's a fucker. So he could. He thinks so. He's an antagonist, right? Shut down all of his other sites. She wants to yank it out. Or fight me, because Jamie's not real happy right now. I'm happy she woke up now that we're fighting her. That doesn't quite look good. So anyway, we eventually kind of excavate her. Took a long time. What the hell? So I got 2 drugs in there. Right, so now that's where we have to kind of go. It's okay, so wait a minute.
What's the half-life of the morphine?
The half-life of the morphine. I've got 100 milligrams of morphine, 2 milligrams of narcan. What are the half-life?
Right.
All the stuff kind of comes in the blood. The narcan does turn it off. So everything's fine and dandy, but you got to kind of put that in the back of your brain going, okay, I gave this drug, all these drugs have half-life. What are the differences? And that's where you got to kind of think through. He was kind of going, we really should be doing this. It's kind of in our protocols. We should probably. And didn't think it was that reaction. That's what kind of one of those little rhythm on. We would have ventilated it, taken her up to the hospital.
But if you go to the hospital fund, there's a podcast that Dr. Geiger, the hospital fund has. Yes.
Okay, so do that. Right, so Andy, you have to. So talk about respiration. Constipation. Is that that, right? Urinary retention kind of goes along with the whole slowing down of the GI motility, basically kind of causes some vasal constriction, so basically kind of causes people, can cause people to not function. Cough depression, there are some functional hypothesis. A lot of these drugs will actually go and send it, there's a, what's called the chemotherapy zone, yeah. There's a bottom center basically in the brain. There are drugs that directly stimulate that. And that's what these do. Increased CO2, increased ICP. Indirectly, basically because there's a relationship, and we'll get to Sean, we'll talk more about it, but there's a relationship between how fast you breathe, CO2, and vasoconstriction. As you increase your CO2 levels, it causes vasoconstriction. It causes vasoconstriction. Actually, no, I'm kidding. It causes vasodilation. But it causes vasodilation. There's more fluid, there's more flow. When you have the ventilator, it causes vasoconstriction. It's placing less blood flow in the lower flow. Euphoria, dysphoria, right? Sedation, people constriction, which is meiosis, they can't do it. And vasodilation, which means you drop pretty low in aspirin. So the contraindications to giving this medication would be what? Hypertension, possibility for hypertension. What else? Yep. Yep.
Only B, cough.
Okay. Yep. What else?
B, okay.
Yeah, we're already in the first question.
No, it's just the airway.
Okay. Yep. Absolutely. You all see how all this kind of plays together? Okay. All right. So good, so we good, so that makes sense. Opioids. Non-opioids. Sound serious, we didn't have to prototype. And then we got kids that's not sure what they have to do. The hurt, the clock, the portal, and these are all things that. Now, drugs work with each other. Basically, all of these NSAIDs basically work with protein. So, of humans, the part is one of the big proteins, right? A lot of these drugs hit drive on proteins. By giving one drug, you'll kind of start to see this. So basically, if the patients are taking aspirin, and now they take this. This competes for the protein body size. If the drug is bound to the protein, then it works. It doesn't do its job. Yeah. You give a drug that displaces some of the protein, there's more drug in circulation. It's going to change the rate at which things get metabolized and work. Make sense?
So it doesn't last longer, right?
Because then
well, if you use the protein and release it down,
right, or actually it'll change, it'll work faster. So if I take aspirin, and all my aspirin's hanging around like this, and I'm just kind of taking a ride, I take this drug, it displaces aspirin, there's now more aspirin, preform aspirin, to allow it to do its thing.
Yeah.
Or keep away. It'll work both ways. Well, but they have different, ultimately these things are working at different sites. All of these work at different times.
They only being have combat with nothing.
Right. Yeah. So just kind of understand that. That's where you'll see a lot of the drugs that kind of says these two drugs don't play well together. It's because they're interfering with how they work either at the receptor site or the transport. So it's a fairly common thing. Now, a couple things. So when folks are, if you get hurt at home, but you just get pain medicine, not all pain medicine is okay. So aspirin, you got to reduce fever, right? So everybody reduces fever. Everybody has pain. Not everybody wants for inflammation. So if you have an area that's swollen, then you want to reduce the inflammation, which will help also improve healing. Tylenol doesn't necessarily do that. Acetaminophen doesn't heal. So it may be better to recommend, because all folks go, acetaminophen and ibuprofen are the same. It's not necessarily true. You got to kind of stand back and go, why would I want one or the other? Does it make a difference? So if you truly just had a headache and that's all you want, sure it works. But a lot of my headaches, inflammation. A lot of my headaches are kind of inflammatory processes that are there. This stuff works better for me because of that. So not everything equals. If you look at this one, you know, I'd like an anti-inflammatory. company.
So Aspen has the same problem. Stop the surfaces of cyclooctanes, cops. And they went to Cox 1, Cox 2, and took it clean. That's cops. Cops does two things. It helps produce frosted rain, it helps produce boxing. Frosted rain will cure that. These things are responsible for pain. As the body stimulates prostate glands are things that go to the nerve side, so you should feel pain. Prostate glands suppress gastric acid secretion. Promote secretion of gastric acid by carbonate, mediates inflammatory response, and reduces fever. What from a feeding job? You give aspirin, cough isn't disease, cross the glands aren't disease, therefore no pain, therefore no disease. But we also have now, we've got a bad side effect, right? Now we have an increase of gastric acid secretion. We're not increasing gastric mucus production. So you see now, for real, the side effects of aspirin are increased GI bleeding. Ulcers, and that kind of makes sense. Now, the other thing that why we take aspirin, long term, right? Quite a good idea. The Buxton A2 is basically the thing that allows the platelets to grab each other. Right? We got these things. So the good things, which kind of talked about, right? So those are the pain drops, fees, and drops in. Okay. Bad things, it leads to increased GI ulcers, increased bleeding, drops renal wound, and decreases renal contractions. Which, if you're trying to stop them, is a good thing. But if you're in the process, So this stuff is stuck. So good? Okay. So acetaminophen, right? So basically, acetaminophen, what makes it a little different is that it inhibits the synthesis of CNS prostaglandins. It doesn't affect systemic. So this works in the brain, therefore we don't have the systemic side effects. So, again, similar things, but you kind of got to say, what are my ultimate goals? What am I trying to accomplish? And then you can also find them. Now, y'all ever heard of the acetaminophen under? A lot of folks kind of think in this long problem with over-the-counter medications. Acetaminophen is very common. People kind of think, I can take lots of them. If you take lots of folks, you kind of like, if you're following the prescribing information, it's okay. If you don't follow the prescribing information, unfortunately, that's a lot of folks that they go, oh, I just want to get some attention. I'm going to overdose on Tylenol, and they take Tylenol because they think it's not going to do anything. Tylenol, you die of a nasty death 3 or 4 weeks later. So, in normal, what happens, right? So, acetaminophen, typically, how it's metabolized is it goes through a major pathway and gets non-toxic metabolites. But
this is kind of like a two-lane road. Lots of cars can go down it, but when you start trying to throw 1,000 cars down the road, backs up. So what do you see what happens on the freeway when there's an accident and you're down the one lane? Yeah, what do people do? Right. So they go, I'm going to exit here. Maybe I can find you a different route. That's exactly what the city mentioned. It finds a minor pathway. It finds one of the side lanes. But the secondary lane, people are thinking in time. It's actually very lots of drugs to metabolize by this thing. Right? It has its people at the enzyme. It's also metabolized. The problem is it metabolizes it with toxic metabolites. But toxic metabolites will destroy your liver. Generally, though, there's kind of a safety factor. Glutathione is also there in the liver. And so when it becomes a toxic metabolite, as long as you have glutathione, it becomes a non-toxic metabolite. The problem is, there's only so much of this. You run out of this. It's going to be a toxic metabolite. It's going to destroy the liver. Make sense? So, and there's two pathways. So this, if alcohol is actually, alcohol, there's similar processes with alcohol. To take alcohol, it leads you down this pathway. And takes away this. So a lot of the folks, yeah, I'm going to take Tylenol, I'm overdosing, I'm going to take some alcohol just to kind of ease my pain. It's too bad. So now, if we recognize it, treat it early, there's actually a couple of ways to replace this with something that is euphemistic. There's a couple of things you can actually do with folks that will actually minimize how many toxic metabolites we got. I don't like to allow them to be metabolized. But it's being able to detect it. And so that's where when you get this, you got to go, ooh, and recognize that this is an urgency. And you need to start moving. Because the hospital needs to get notified because they're going to get out of this stuff. Well, all this metabolism is done in the liver. So all of this stuff's hanging out there. So if you don't have this, these metabolites are in the liver and causing liver damage. And certainly, they're in circulation. So, but if this stops, so basically, you overdose, okay? You run out of the components to make this, and you use it up, and your body can't. It's like, okay, we're ordering part 3, part 2, basically means whatever it is, we got to intake that, or we got to get it, or we got to build it up. In the meantime, all that's trying to, they're trying to get the parts, the liver's been destroyed. Yes. Yeah, that's what that means.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Very simple. I don't know if it's exact, but it's the same thing. We don't carry it. The problem is we don't carry it. And a lot of folks basically, you know, when they're doing some suicide, I'll classify it as all, maybe not, but some suicide is a detention. You have issues, you need to discuss them, and this is how to make a point to you, or another good person. And so a lot of folks don't, you know, they take it, then they go to sleep, they wake up, they go, that was stupid. And the problem is, they don't get help. Your liver is a living organ, and so if it's not, if you are able to survive it, then your liver will either infest it. But then it's, so depending on how much is left in the egg, you need to be able to do a little transplant and stuff, but it's a living organ, so depending on your health, is its ability to repair it. And it'll, because that's long-term,
long-term abuse.
Yeah.
So that you stop, so you start getting alcohol so it just gets the reptiles is a little different, but if the shrubs is a result of alcoholism, well, when you stop, it will improve. May not return back to where it was originally. But it's not a cirrhosis, it necessarily. It's a. I don't feel good. I'm not so sure. So it looks like so. All right, so anesthetics. All right, so this is a loss of sensation. In many cases, with a loss of consciousness. Okay. And it may just be that, hey, you actually go out, or there's a displacement. Where you're still there. You're still awake. But you have a different perception of what's happening. But so a lot of folks like Kevin and Doug, well, they'll describe it, they were there, they remember the event, but their perception is that they weren't in their body, they were out of their body, looking out. It's generally occurs basically, right? So anesthetics, we feel pain because of nerve propagation. Basically, that what the anesthetics do is they stop the nerve propagation. Okay. There's a couple. So gases, so nitrous oxide, which is one some of the nurses can relieve pain. Ether, so basically the stuff when you guys are in the OR, those gases that they're given, and a lot of cases are anesthetics. IV stuff, right? So you heard of ketamine, tromadine, valium, propofol, propofol. Those are all IVs. Make sense? Now, you can basically do stuff locally or systemically, right? So anybody gets different things? So before they put them on there, or you went to the dentist, they teach stuff, right? So they do local anesthetics, right? So they inject stuff. The most common one, vitamin. Lidocaine is a sodium channel blocker. It basically blocks the sodium channels. In some cases, they'll do it, depending on where they're doing it, but they'll actually put it in there with epi. Epi causes the vasoconstriction, so they don't have to worry about the bleeding stuff. So they can get in there and do stuff to cause it, so they don't have to worry about the bleeding, and you don't feel it. But you don't feel the pain. You feel pressure, but you can still feel it when they start doing stuff in your mouth and your arm. You can still kind of feel the pressure. Don't feel the pain. Okay. Yeah, cocaine is actually local anesthetic. That's what I was going to say. I had a friend in college, his name is Felipe. He's from Panama. He laughs because he got to a fight and he got his nose busted. So let's put it, so basically, and you will actually, a lot of the EDs actually have cocaine, but it's four, so when they can actually pack it. So if you break the nose, they can basically put it up, pack it up in there, so that you don't do it. Anti-anxiety, sedative, hypnotic drug. So basically, you drop sedation, decrease anxiety, and inhibition.
sense that says,
no.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The common sense is standing back going, you know, it's probably a bad idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, but do you hold this and watch this kind of thing?
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
That's right. Yep. Yeah. So that's in it. So the things do, right? And so a lot of these are actually part of the gateway drug. That's a lot of what they do because of that.
All right. So hypnosis basically is instigation, sleeping, you think.
And these are also insomnia drugs, so they're used in the treatment of insomnia. What do you see on TV? The people want to So, insomnia has two issues. Okay. A latency, what's a latency? So when we talk about latency, what is it? Right? So you give the drug and there's a period between which you start that drug.
Right.
Latency is basically, the sleep is you lay down, you go to sleep. And God has a very long latency. Down, so wait an hour to get to sleep. Insomnia basically has people have increased latency in treatment. So this helps them. And increased latency, so they wake up in the morning. So that's the definition of insomnia. So they need to take some medication. There's classes of this stuff. You may have heard of barbiturates, benzodiazepines, and benzos, alcohol. All of these basically work very, very similar. They're all anti-anxiety. But they work differently, right? Okay. Have y'all talked about gabapentin yet? Yeah.
Excellent. So you know what it is? You're talking about it.
Yeah, so GABA is gamma aminobutyric acid. It is the chief CNS inhibitory transmitter. So you got things that basically are stimulants, and things that are inhibitory. GABA is a thing that inhibits those together. So now with this, benzos. So GABA is a receptor site. So GABA is a neurotransmitter, which basically means it has a receptor site, right? So it releases it and has to work with that receptor site. Benzos work with, benzos and barbiturates both kind of work with that GABA site. The benzos stimulate an area that basically makes the GABA more effective. So when it does match up, so you've got a benzo that's in there, and the GABA goes in there, and you know you get a better receptor site, it has a better effect. Barbiturates can do that, but then barbiturates also have one of the arms that can also, it looks just like GABA. It can actually stimulate that GABA receptor site. Make sense? We'll talk more about that. Basically, what these do is they promote hyperpolarization. Hold that thought and explain. It basically it polarizes the cell negatively and makes it more difficult for it to become stimulated, to fire. It does that to chloride. So now, benzos and barbiturates. Barbiturates came out first. Kind of a little history. Barbiturates came out first, and they were wonderful things. People started treating them, they were easy to prescribe. The problem is lots of folks started dying. Because when you overdose on them, bad things happen. The safety profile wasn't any good. The drug companies then came out with the benzos. The benzos have a much safer, much better safety profile. Much harder to overdose and have significant side effects. So those became the biggest problems. folks have moved kind of away from the crowded habitus and not the crowded kind of benzos and non-benzos and similar stuff. Policy?
Like new policies.
Oh, taking up of. Yeah, so, nice, yeah, but this, I guess if you're doing one of the comments. So the kind of factor, right? So benzos have a very good safety profile, carbamazepines have very low. Maximum CNS depression, so again, they're kind of what, similar kind of what Dr. Greenberg said, right? So benzos have a very low CNS depression. Carbamazepines are very high. In fact, there's some carbamazepines you give them a regular dose, they're outperforming. In fact, if they overdose on them, you actually hook them up to an EEG, they don't stay. So not EKG, EEG. The brain activity. So, it depends what the goal is. So, yeah. So, and again, all drugs, that's why these are still out there. They're still prescribed. You can still give them. It ultimately kind of depends what you want. So, say, for example, a person's having a seizure. Normal seizures, you give benzos. Stop the seizure if you like it. Some patients, you can give benzos, that can happen. You give another benzo, that can happen. You give more benzo, that can happen. You've got to get full on the barbiturate before they make it stop. And then they're asleep for 4 days. But the seizure stop, which is kind of, so they got 4 days to kind of figure out what's going on. Yeah, right. Well, yes. So again, respiratory depression, barbiturates are high, suicide patients are high. So the problem is if you do overdose, so if you, a lot of folks again kind of go, well, or if you accidentally overdose in a barbiturate, accidentally overdose in a barbiturate, so folks that are basically not, that are at risk for suicide, So there is an antagonist for, you don't know what it is? Narcan affects what? Opioids affect what, right? So it's not going to affect, in fact, a lot of folks kind of think, so it's a difference. So, first patient's having a seizure, you're supposed to give 2 or 3 of Valium, stop the seizure. Time that you're pushing the syringe, the truck is a pump and you push off. So you end up giving them a point. So you have three mountains. Should you give it? Should you not? So say they still won't think, they won't think, so they are. They're having a pretty fact, they're having a bad thing. So they've had a seizure. I don't know if that's the cause, but if they pick up again, if they start again, so I stopped it. So he's not having a seizure now. But I stopped it. Oh, I didn't stop. I stopped it with a benzo. So I gave too much, so now I'm not sure. I give flunazine and have another seizure. My treatment has been, so that's why you have to, so again, kind of think through all the stuff. Okay? Narcan, the patient overdose is going right here and there on oral opioids, that overdose. Well, just say, well, sure, yeah, but opioids, cancer patients get liquid opioids, so they can drink. Lots of pain, kept drinking it, ultimately, and now you can rest your time. You show up and go, I can do this. And you put your heart in, look at the truth. Lock this up, but you got to rest your time. And so now what you're doing, now what you're doing, there's extreme pain. Right. Well, again, kind of look. So think long, yes, we like to treat the respiratory tract. You have a way to treat the respiratory tract, right? You can bag. Okay. So again, kind of think about why we're giving this stuff. What are the other effects that we don't necessarily want? This antagonist is nice in a hospital setting like the OR. Where they want to wake you up. We're done. They want to wake you up. On a hospital setting, again, we isolated event. Okay, I gave you an important message. They do not. So the beginning of the issue, you don't know. Even if you do, so say you took away the oxygen drop for the doctor. The heroin shot, and you wake them up and back to the end. Yeah, and that's actually what you want to do. You actually want to push it up just to improve that respiratory tract. You don't want to improve the nerve cells. So, but again, you got to kind of figure out how much you're doing. Right. Okay. Okay. Well, but just push. I mean, you push to effect. You just kind of push a little bit. And that's actually what you actually want to do with all of your drugs. Push to effect. I can go up to. If you see them, I can certainly give you five. But if two will stop, if I just kind of go like this and give you a couple seconds, I can just keep just kind of giving little bits. If two stops you, I don't need to give you the rest, I don't need to give you. Well, give a couple seconds. Alright, so then those you've heard of, you've got to buy your first day dinner. Non-benzo is something that has similar side effects. It doesn't work by the benzo receptor. It basically has similar properties when you give it, but it doesn't work. It's not technically a benzo. These typically are very low, like in the room, which is why they kind of make the prescribing, they'll say, here they'll take the tone, they're not kind of. These have a much better safety profile. It's harder because the amounts that people are given are reasonable. Short acting, long acting. The theme of Arbicol is the one that I'm talking about, where it's basically 4 days. Five pin call. I heard two pin. Yeah, the true serum, what the military used to use, so basically when you watch the movies about the bad guys, and they basically put the true serum basically what they're doing is they're giving them a barbiturate, easing their inhibitions where they talk. You really want to talk to them. Maybe you can get some medicine. Yeah, you know, friend. You should get it. You know, you're not instructed. So now the trick was to give them, you know, talk to my mouth, where they get instructed. How are we doing? Any break? No? We good? Okay. Okay. So, Tom, what's this evening? Basically, so instead of it being a controlled discharge of cells,
right.
It's a every cell. So basically, we kind of play the game on here. So basically, if I discharge, it causes everybody else to discharge. So instead of kind of being a controlled manner, in which I want to say, okay, send down this nerve terminal, this one, down the thing that makes it do this. What's actually happening is all the brain, all the cells inside, basically. Where the procedures can be in a specific area, or they can be in the hemisphere, they can be the entire brain. So it depends on how it's spread. So basically what it is the nerve cells are discharged in an unorganized manner, and basically it's like a series of dominoes. One starts, everybody falls. Okay? Alright. So there's lots of ways, there's lots of classes, chemical classes of drugs that they all work on basically the same thing. Ultimately, what we're trying to do is to drop the propagation vacuum. We want to stop the cells from discharging. You can do that by a couple of ways. You can actually block the sodium potassium influx. So you interfere with how the cell depolarizes and repolarizes. And or you hyperpolarize the membrane. Remember earlier we talked about how it basically cause those barbiturates and benzoates basically increase the chloride influx. Okay. Those are the ways that they work. Let's see. So we talked about like some benzos. Now, not all benzos, again, kind of like not all opioids work well. Codeine tends to have a much better effect on cough than morphine does. Things that tend to work quite well with seizures are diazepam and lorazepam. Now, all of them work. Midazolam is also kind of one that's barbiturates, I think about it, probably talked about that. Ativan is actually very nice. You don't have a problem with Ativan, why we don't quite need that. They basically say, because you can actually store it for so many days outside of the refrigerator, but it basically means you've got like a 30-day life. So instead of having a 2-year life, which sits on the shelf, pay with that, you have a 30-day life. But yeah, there's other drugs in there. Yeah. Valium's not. Valium's stable in room temperature. So that's kind of why we think of it. Ion channels basically were affecting the general sodium. Right? So you've heard of valerian. Valerian is actually a sodium channel. Pentol, which they're not quite sure. They know it affects the ion channels. They're not quite sure how it affects it. You know, outdoor guests.
Valines is seedless.
But you could. So valines is a sodium chemical. So it actually has, so depending on how you give it, what you do, it actually could be useful for other
things.
Now, this is a preventive, not an acute treatment here. This stuff is tending to be preventive. So because lidocaine has an issue of hepatic attacks, so it's an IV drug.
Other stuff, yeah, this is basically this and everything that the most stuff that most people do stuff approach. But
things to kind of remember with a lot of these medications, especially the seizure medication, is again, so what's far. So you gotta have there's the therapeutic level of the drug, right? And you gotta have so much of the drug, you gotta be above that point in order for the drug to work. A lot of these seizure medications, you have to have so much in your bloodstream in order for them to do that. So folks, one of the things when they come to go to exams with the doctor is that they go and check every so often, whatever depends on the age and what's happening in vision. But if you have significant changes in your life, you got to go get those levels checked. And so say you were unhealthy, having seizures, you started getting saved, you lost the test. Well, that lack of adipose tissue now may affect how much you're having to take. And so they may check your levels and say, oh, you're taking too much, you're not taking enough. So with the seizure medications, part of the history that you need to ask them. What is it? It's all fun for the
others.
They could depends on what they're looking for.
So maximum therapy
talk to me about the fusion. Is it? Right? So what we're talking about here, basically the ions are sodium, calcium, potassium.
Why is the concentration gradient? Why is that seeming?
Yeah. Right, so in order to have basically, so if we want to have a lot of fusion, we got to have high concentration gradient in this area to get more of it.
How does electrical gradient affect that?
Yeah, and basically you got to have keep everything balanced.
Okay.
Right, now we have these ion channels, right? How these things work, right? Because we have this positive ion that tries to get through. Well, there's gated channels that allow stuff to get through. Gates open, you're allowing stuff to go in or out depending on which way it's going to go. Alright? So now, sodium. Is sodium an intracellular ion? Is it primarily an intracellular ion or an extracellular ion? Right? So here's the exterior, right? So there's an extracellular ion. So there's more outside than inside. Potassium, obviously, is the opposite of it, right? Chloride. Right? So sodium goes in, potassium goes out. Now, these are the two things. So when you have a cell that depolarizes, it's actually happening, right? So you have a bursting membrane potential. When that cell fires, basically, sodium comes rushing in. And that's depolarization. And then repolarizing, one of the primary things is just potassium from the rushing out. Does that make sense?
Okay. Why did we talk about chloride?
could pull out. Yeah, we were talking about hyperpolarization. What was the original concept there? Yeah, right. So dealing with gap. So dealing with gamma bindings and barbitures. So bindings and barbitures work with gamma. Alright. So here's nitrogen. So this is basically if you kind of respect a little measurement near a cell when the cell was depolarizing. Actually, here's kind of what we see. So when the cell was at resting, when it wasn't doing anything, in fact, it's resting and then breaking. The normal difference that we measure from the inside out is it sits at about negative 7 millivolts. And there's a couple things that can happen. Either the cell can kind of leak, or you have some sort of stimulus, something causes the cell to depolarize. In some cases, you can kind of hit giant and kind of create a chain reaction. And so it can be an external stimulus, or it can be an internal stimulus, because if I have a slow leak, if I allow calcium or something to leak out, and it starts to leak out, you kind of see how this kind of slowly goes up, and as it's going up, this is the threshold. When it gets above negative 50, what happens is basically all the doors open. So there's also the doors basically on the cell wall. Whenever membrane potential millivolts gets above 50, it goes automatically. What do you say comes in? Sodium, right? So basically, I can either be leaking or I can have some sort of external stimulus that causes this membrane potential to go up above 50. It's 50, fires up and shoots all the way up to the floor. Sodium comes rushing in, right? Sodium's a positive ion, as I basically measure this, I'm getting positive results. So what did I say what happened when the cell depolarized? Potassium rushes out, right? So down rushing out, see what's happening? That membrane potential is dropping down. Sodium comes rushing in, which shoots up here. That comes in. This is and it's a relative thing. Because we're dealing with the small area. Overall, cells have homeostasis. Right? We're looking at this one small area and saying inside versus outside, there's a relative negative potential. That's a positive ion. But that movement of the positive ion, right? So basically, if I'm having sodium rushing in, as I measure it, I've got more positive charges. And potassium goes rushing out. In essence, we're adding negative charges, we're subtracting positive charges. So it's going to drop in that direction. Okay? So this is an action potential. An action potential is a cell depolarizing. Actually, cell depolarizing is depolarizing. This is depolarization, that's depolarization. So this concept we're talking about here of hyperpolarization. The resting membrane potential, which is where things sit at neutral. Well, basically what it's saying, right? So what you said, right? So we have sodium rushing in, potassium rushing out. There you go, right? So the potassium pump is kind of constantly running in the background, kind of reset or restoring the balances between sodium and potassium.
Now, hypopolarization is kind of before the stimulus flows. You still get that kind of the extra.
Well, what we're talking about here with just the single cell is more just hyperpolarization. We'll get to the hyperpolarization. Right? Well, actually, so normally you say the resting membrane potential, you see how it's dropping down below that resting one? That's hyperpolarization. Is that what I'm saying? Okay. November comes early, we got sodium in the trap. So this makes sense? So good. Sodium comes in, potassium goes out, and the rest of the thing goes to the basal threshold. Negative 7. Pops up the line, positive 30. So what does it? Basically, it does it because that leaks. It leaks calcium and it leaks sodium. And as it leaks, it starts slowly. So we're kind of leaking in. Yep. Calcium and both of them coming in. So we're both coming in, right? Because we're slowly kind of creeping up to this. And once there's enough of it in, it says, I get, what, open it open. Depends on the data line. Good. Calcium goes up. It ultimately depends on. It ultimately depends on what you're looking at. A muscle cell? Nerve cell, heart cell, I think it also depends on. Correct. But I won't say the negative 70 is nerve, specific people. Well. So we got a question. So what happens if the membrane of chloride rushes into the cell during repolarization? So we have a normal process of sodium potassium. If we allow chloride to go into the cell during depolarization, what's going to happen? That's where we get into this hyperpolarization. Right? Now, if that occurs, if what happens to frequency if it hyperpolarizes? It's going to move further. Right? So, can you see that? So our normal process is, right? Which kind of makes sense. So we want to slow everything down. We're having seizures, but the cells are depolarizing, and going through them. We give value to open up those chloride channels. It takes it longer to fire. We slow everything down. But you get down here, right? So we got to get back up to normal before we can even kind of go. So if I'm down here at negative 90 now, that's a much further step to get up to 50 than the clock. It takes a lot greater stimulus to get up there at the clock. All right. Alright, so what does it say data means? Data means going for mineral immunobutyric acid. And it is the chief neurotransmitter. It's an inhibitory neurotransmitter. It's the primary inhibitory neurotransmitter. So we have GABA comes in, opens it up, and basically what it does is it opens up the receptor site and allows chloride to come rushing in. It is proper chloride to do. GABA tends to take a bigger role, right, than it does during wake periods. We can enhance things by giving medications. So there are times when you kind of want to you know, you kind of take some, you know, feeling anxious or dream, but take some deep breaths and kind of slow yourself down. Part of what you're doing is gap is having a goal. GABA opens up the channel.
Overall,
the cells are neutral. If you stand back, global view, looking at the cells, you're going, all I see is neutral. When you zoom in to street level, and I look at inside, the left side of the street versus the right side of the street, inside the cell versus the left side of the street, that's where I see differences. Yeah. So we have this benzoreceptor over here. Benzo comes in. Benzo in conjunction with GABA basically really means, okay, not only did we open up the doors, we opened up the back doors, we took the French doors and we swung them wider open, shut them open away. It really makes sense. It depends on this, so it's a constant. So some cells, so it could be that, and drop that while the cell's resting. It could be while it's moving. So if it's a heart cell, and you want to slow it down. So I feel that, so you're awake, you have GABA there. So even though your cells are functioning, right, you're hearing stuff, seeing stuff. I give enough benzo to get some. So it could be, while some things are at rest, some things are functioning. So it's a moving picture. So we're here with all the depressants, sediment components. How are we doing? Not okay? Brain's not falling. Going up on ground.
How do you know that hyperpolarity is defined as positive and negative? To me,
it's a net. Taking away problems. So I have.
That's what I was thinking. To me, the alpha is
But it's a relative. Everything's in relation to each other. Ultimately, everything's neutral. If you stand back far enough, it's all neutral.
Right.
You only see changes when you zoom in close enough. In order for stuff, that's kind of what we were talking about earlier, in order for stuff to work, you have to have differences in charges. Otherwise, everything's flat and dead. So that effect's going to hit, so just guy is going to hit the EMS stuff. If you search for the 200 most prescribed drugs, find the list of those, that's going to be really good. It's the ones that are strong. So the whole good list is both. It's most commonly prescribed and found in the starred ones are also a combination of three hospitals.
But with the polarization, how is it polarized? Inside you have positive passengers, and the outside you have positive. Yeah, but it's polarized.
So inside the cell, there's all sorts of things that we're passing. And we're looking, so...
When the EEG they come in point that the channel's open, sodium starts coming in, the negative charge of, and this is while I think about 7 meters, the negative charge inside the cell also attracts, like, you get a big flood because it's just attracting more, you know, the negative charges attract more and more of the positive sodium. Which opens more, you know, when it gets propagated along until you reach the peak. And then it's testing with other channels that you have to leave. That's all that is. It's always about the testing is negative, and that's why you have to pull it basically. That's positive on the outside of the
negative. Well, you could actually, so we can work with that. So we'll say that there's a load of negative charge inside the cell.
Right. Right. So there's some that's protein, right?
Opens it up. It opens up and you're right. So sodium says, oh, hey, more negative inside, I need to go inside. So you got lots of sodium coming in. So now, the sodium comes rushing in. There's a relative negative charge outside the cell. The potassium gates open, and they go, oh. Potassium,
so
goes, potassium goes rushing out.
Right.
Because there's a relative negative, because there's a relative loss of sodium on the
right.
Outside.
So it's a depolarization.
It's relative.
It'd be like, you know, like a sympathetic antagonist, would be the name of it, It was in the book we talked about, like, there is no extra book to you. But like, you need a relative response, like, you know, like sympathetic.
What was that? So and there's lots of, the next week I'll need you, there's lots of cotton that are free. Right.
I want to go get some ice and nuggets.
Isn't that good? I thought we were in the... I'm talking about Elspeed, you got to fight back. Hi, you guys. I'm sorry. Uh-oh. Have a good evening. The spinners.
Right?
The spinners side thing? Take them down? Caffeine. Apple dampens. Apple dampens. Caffeine to apple dampens. The often. Where's the often? Methamphetamine. Methamphetamine. Where you get stuff like the diet suppression, really kind of controlled all the 5-hour energy drinks, that there was some sort of version of this CNS stimulation stuff. How it works, basically, cognitively, so you have in your brain, right, you have basically neurotransmitters that excite stuff, dopamine, norepinephrine. Basically, we use the ketamine to come to the release of more epinephrine, dopamine, and pain. Those are basically stimulatory, monoamines, what they call it. Stimulant things are in there. Right? So what part of that is, this is the fact that, right? So, again, kind of more epinephrine, dopamine, if they're wearing that, you can start either three. Take too much, and it's going to stay in that thing and have it fall in there. Depending on the dose of it, it's going to be a second. That's not it. So kids that are hyperactive get a stimulant. What? Right. They have a, so folks that have ADHD, one of the facts is that there's an imbalance between the excitatory and inhibitory stuff. And so what they're trying to do is self-stimulate. They're easily distracted. So you give them a stimulant which brings the stuff in balance and you're able to focus. Yeah. Right. So here's a sales point, right? So go to the parents, so the kids are already hyperactive, so we're going to get the stimulus. Yeah. That was something. Rebalancing the system. In fact, that's actually some folks don't think, not realizing. The folks that drink a lot of coffee, I mean, because basically this ADHD thing kind of relatively new, right? 20 years ago when I was a kid, or 40 years ago when I was a kid, it wasn't there. But a lot of these folks have kind of grown up and they basically self-medicate. So my mom was, she was, I don't know, not really have that, but both of them came up. Kind of a self-medical.
So you don't have it.
Yeah. I've tried to quit several times, so I want to go by 6 times.
So the normal part of the internment out is
yeah. And people do. They sell the drugs, yeah.
Yeah.
Right. So the methyl xanthine, caffeine, guanine, theophylline, stearidone, amylophylline, these are drugs for medication. How these actually work is you've not heard of ginseng. Okay, so the medication is given for sacking, so for SCP, right? Heard of a ginseng triphosphate? A ginseng. It's an adenosine molecule that has three phosphates on it. So is it making the connection to that? These work with the adenosine receptor sites, turn off and back in the office. Hold this thought for the stick here. Alright, so patients taking the office, becomes tachycardic, has SPP. You guys already said you want to give it in. So if you come through this, you get somebody that's kind of go, oh, wait a minute, yeah, I just put a little bit. I just did this while I'm on this drug. I've taken a shot of caffeine, whatever it is, right? You may spin back and go, probably just double the dose of this because I've been smoking.
Is it more colorful?
It's like saying beta blockers block all the drugs. And in reality, a lot of these kind of have to go, alright, so portions of stuff is more than the caffeine. Right, coffee is possible.
has stopped them.
They didn't pay them 5 million.
All right. Monoamines.
So we talked about monoamines. Monoamines are basically the neurotransmitters, or the primary neurotransmitters. Norepinephrine and serotonin are the primary ones that we work with within the brain. And they're doing this psychotherapeutic stuff. The thought is briefer for someone with schizophrenia or bipolar. There's an imbalance between all these minds. There's an imbalance between the excitatory and inhibitory neurotransmitters. Our goal is to basically kind of balance all this stuff out. Very much the persons, they are unaware. They're basically, they can't disassociate reality from the rest of their mind. So we go and we kind of daydream about stuff and we go, okay, we're daydreaming. To them, they're living. There's a point I was kind of curious to think about. It basically where his son was alive. Someone got killed. And he goes to sleep with his son. Yeah, he goes to sleep with his son and he wakes up and he looks at his wife or something like that. And that's what I was talking about. That's very much a schizophrenia concept. Although schizophrenia, typically it's when they're awake, they're in both worlds. That one is truly kind of a cut and dry, now, what they think is from an increased dopamine release. So what our goal is to do is that the two classes are phenylphenophthalates and herphenophthalates. Big class, and have you all heard of Haldol? Okay, Haldol is phenylphenophthalates, and phenylphenophthalates. So other stuff that works, bipolar, so bipolar. Yeah, it's extremely extreme. So from depression to mania, and mania is like a beat in the heart. Correct? Yeah, part of it, you can have both, yeah, you can, it's involuntary moves. Yeah, so you got, so, you can have tics where they just kind of, my daughter has a little bit of it where she'll show the point. And unless you sit there and look at it, kind of goes, it's abnormal. Most folks don't see that. But it can also be verbal, where they have tics with voice, where verbal is all of a sudden blurred out. So. Dementia, organic brain syndrome, a lot of these can also be used for prevention of emesis. How they work basically, depending on the mechanism somewhere, as far as the neurophenones and the phenophysins, the mechanism by which they work, where you kind of get the difference in terms of the strength and potency. So the strength is kind of basically something very potent. What does that mean? Yeah, right? So potent is a very little bit goes a long way. Strength is how strong. So you can have something very strong, not necessarily very potent, or you can have something very strong and very potent. So what we're looking at is phenophysins have a low potency, where phenones have a high potency. Your phenome? How about? Okay. how it basically works. They are receptor antagonists. So there's dopamine, and dopamine actually has several receptors. So the dopamine 2 receptor in the brain, you block that receptor site, which leads to the therapeutic effect. Now, it also has some side effects. Cholinergic effects, histamine effects, norepinephrine, alpha-1. Stimulates alpha-1 receptors. Muscarinic cholinergic. What is that? Yeah, we're going to stimulate the effect, right? So, these are the other stimulant effects. These are the side effects you have to kind of deal with. That's the desire. So, side effects are really short term. Now, they can lead to kind of what's called extrapyramidal symptoms. And actually, Google, yes, you look up YouTube. I didn't look at it, but there's actually two videos that actually look professionally kind of down the hook at the beginning of the morning. And kind of talks about what you do. And we'll get there in a second. Now, the cholinergic effect. Right? Parasympathetic. You kind of slow everything down. We have intracholinergic effect. And so we block it all. Leads to kind of a dry mouth. Prototropia, these are the side effects. By taking this medication, I go deal with this. I don't like being outside. I'm not ready to sit in a bathroom passenger. Orthostatic hypertension, sedation, sexual dysfunction. Now, these extrapyramidal symptoms, these can kind of come well, and these are kind of interesting. You can take this drug for a very long time, and it doesn't have any effects. One day you wake up and you had a lot of this stuff. Or, so you could be on years and not have issues and all of a sudden have an issue. Or you can start taking it and have an issue. The acute dystonia is the one that we tend to kind of see a lot. All of a sudden you can have spasms and you're coming up facing back. And what they get is kind of, you walk up and go, how about, right? Yeah, well, you walk up and go, you're taking how about, and they're going, Yeah, you have an acute dystonic reaction. We'll get there. All right, you can also have long-term kind of effects of Parkinsonian. So I've seen folks with Parkinson's where they have difficulty walking and they tremble. And with that, akinesthesia, compulsive, repetitive motions, agitation, and basically where you kind of start to get this thing. So now, certainly, this is an acute event, these are kind of progression, so if they continue to take it, they stop taking it, this doesn't progress. If they can, they continue taking it, they don't realize how it's going on. Anticholinergic effect, basically kind of what they think a lot of that acute dystonic reaction is working with the dopamine 2 receptor sites in the brain that's kind of leading to this anticholinergic effect. If that you can treat the anticholinergic with vinegar, remember histamine is kind of one of those things that was working with? It's kind of a goofy reaction, but yeah, by giving simply somebody that walks up and you go, they're having this acute dystonic reaction. Therapy is actually given them benefit. Yeah, it's all dealing with brain, chemical balances in the brain. It's still taking a lot of kind of work to wrap my head around. But it's working with dopamine, which is a vasodilator. So those are the best ones. All right. And in the process again, if they can come out and get modeling, treatment options, what we're doing to do is increase neural transmitter. So increasing neural transmitter synthesis, release from the bulb. We want to make more. We want to release more. Or we want to block the uptake. So basically what we want is more neurotransmitters. So either we're making more, we're releasing more, not storing them, or after we do release them, we're keeping them up. Well, and this all basically deals with the junction, right? So you've got a receptor on this side, and a nerve terminal on this side, and then this synapse, I want to have a bunch of transmission. I want to have a bunch of neurotransmitters. Do I hurt tricyclics, TCAs? These are kind of starting to make a little comeback. They were stopped for a while because they had a very low safety profile. Patients would overdose on them and die. Basically, what these do, they block the uptake of norepinephrine and serotonin. Basically, the phenophyte zones and the phenophyte zones, all kinds of things. So we're basically dealing with the cholinergic effects and the hypertension process. Basically, again, because this is a balance, even though you think norepinephrine, but norepinephrine is a neurotransmitter. We typically think of norepinephrine as, okay, I want to get first with norepinephrine to help it. In the brain, you have inhibitory and excitatory. So this is causing a sedation. It also has that anticholinergic effect. It also has toxic effects. Very easily leads to ventricular disorders, which is why it had that poor safety. Actually, what it did, so when you overdose with TCAs, actually what it does is it prolongs the QT interval. It makes the QRS complex wide, and it leads to dysrhythmia. Now, those weren't real safe. Those were kind of the original treatments. Basically, again, don't sound real safe, weren't real safe. The next version came out, and these are selective serotonin reuptake. So TCA is basically good with norepinephrine and serotonin. These are basically the serotonin elements. So the element of serotonin levels, similar results psychologically, don't have the side effects of all the TCAs. So nausea and insomnia, which is a little bit easier to deal with. TCA does have the sexual dysfunction. All right. Monoamine oxidized inhibitor. So your monoamines, so what were your monoamines? Right. So in your body, you have monoamine oxidized inhibitors. Actually, you have monoamine oxidized. Monoamine oxidized take monoamines and break them down. If you break down monoamines, that basically means they can't function. The inhibitor stops monoamine oxidized from functioning. So basically that means more of them to work. Make sense? Alright? Now, this monoamine oxidized is played with liver intestines and the split figure of the monoamine releasing inhibitor. The problem with this is that you also take in, during the same, you take in monoamines. If you choose it, wine has high levels of sustainable carbon, which also is classified as a monomer.
So if you put any alive,
pyrimine is not broken down. Pyrimine is similar to norepinephrine. So hold up thought for a minute. Alright? So basically, this leads to CNS stimulation, right? Because basically this works on all of it. Norepinephrine, dopamine, serotonin. So we have an increase in these neurotransmitters. So we have more anxiety agitation going. Also leads to this hypertensive crisis. I want to say it's the big part can lead to hypertensive crisis. Pyrimine basically does lead to systemically. So, normally, here's what happens, right? So, you ingest cheese, okay? You ingest pyrimine. In the liver, we have monoamine oxidase. It breaks down pyrimine and methylamine. You take monoamine oxidase inhibitors. You ingest cheese. It now goes to the neurotransmitters. It causes the release of norepinephrine. Arterials in the heart now basically release norepinephrine. Primary neurotransmitter for the sympathetic system, right? There's friction, increased heart rate, right? That's the hypertensive crisis. Make sense? So this one of the, if somebody's on an NAOI inhibitor, they have to learn about pyrimine. They have to learn about what foods pyrimine is, and they have to avoid those. So this is one where you kind of go all of a sudden, well, wait a minute, I don't have a history of hypertension, I'm having a hypertension crisis. And you're looking at the list going, well, you just have a cycle. And you got to go, this is an MAOI. What have you eaten? Make sense? Yep. All right, let's see what else. Okay, so summarizing, right, so MAOIs, the breakdown of the monoamine just basically means there's more of it. PCAs and SSRIs block the reuptake. Right? So selective SSRIs is selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor. Functions on which one? Serotonin. PCAs work with
Thank you.